Hi everybody, very welcome to Mentour and yet another video podcast. As always, I hope you're doing absolutely fantastic out there. So today we'll be continuing the medical series that we started last week. And today I will be talking to, once again, former airline captain and aeromedical examiner Mickey Schur about the most common questions that you guys have been sending into the channel. All of those questions that you've been asking over these the past 2 years, or at least the most common ones, will be covered in this episode. So stay tuned, you are going to love this one. Right, Mickey. Yeah. So, there has been literally a ton of questions being sent into my YouTube channel.
I can imagine.
And obviously what I've been saying and what I will be continuing to say on my channel is that I am not an aeronautical medical examiner, so I will not be able to answer questions that are, you know, regarding medical issues or whatever it might be. But what I can do is I can get a contact with someone like Mickey, who can actually answer the questions or at least refer you to where you should be looking in case it's some special case, right? So let's start with some of the questions that have been coming in then. Can you become a professional pilot and have glasses?
Yes, you can become a professional pilot class one and have glasses.
Yes, what are the limits?
The limits are, I mean, they're not super strict, but they are what we call plus 6 to minus 5 myopia, and that is, I would say that's a pretty grave vision loss.
Yeah.
But if you can correct it with glasses, and also there's what you call astigmatism with plus 2 also, but that is a little bit more, not so common.
Mm.
But you can actually, if you can correct it with glasses or lenses with that, you are welcome to fly.
Okay, so basically, you can have quite bad vision.
Yeah.
And correct it with glasses. And as long as that is, you're just going to get a limitation in your certificate.
Yeah, you will have a limitation that you, when you fly, you have to have, you have to wear the correct glasses in order to see properly.
Which, for example, I do. I wear glasses. I have in my medical medical certificate that I need to have a spare pair of glasses with me whenever I fly, on top of the ones that I'm actually wearing.
Yes.
So that is basically what's going to happen if you are within these limits.
Yeah. Now, but I also would say you can also have lenses.
Yeah.
But you also have to have spare lenses or spare glasses with you then, if you should lose one, so you can correct your vision, so you can see properly when you fly.
Yes.
So both alternatives are fine.
Great, great. So that settles that. Once and for all, yes, you can have glasses and become a pilot.
Yes.
Now, the question then becomes, which a lot of people have been asking about as well, is laser surgery to the eyes.
Okay.
Now, LASIK surgery is one name of it. I'm not sure if that is an actual medical term or if it's a company description of it.
Yeah.
But what's your opinion when it comes to laser surgery?
Yeah, I've seen some cases during my career, and I wish these are very special cases. And I referred them more or less 100% to a person like me or an aeromedical examiner, but also specialist in ophthalmology, eye diseases.
Okay.
Because I don't have enough cases to do it myself, and I want those cases to be treated the right way. But my recommendation, since I've been flying myself for 28 years and with experience from that, and with experience that I talk to patients, pilots who have done the surgery without consulting specialists.
Mm.
And there are even people who lost their certificates when they've done this without the proper investigation before.
Okay.
The thing that can affect you, that you get a halo effect, that you don't see all things as you should see them. You can be defects in your vision. And the problem for men is that the night vision get worse.
Okay.
There are tests you can do afterwards in order to see to evaluate the condition. But if you can correct your vision with glasses, my opinion is don't do the surgery until your pilot career is over.
Okay.
Because why take the chance?
Okay. So I'm just gonna emphasize that, guys. So basically, there are risks when it comes to laser surgery, okay?
Yes.
The risks are fairly significant. You can get, as an effect of the surgery, you can get halo effects and stuff like that, which will then disable your chances to get the class one medical.
Yes, that's true.
That's the risk
that you're running. Yeah, that's the risk. Not 100% for all, but there is a risk, and we cannot define the risk beforehand,
no.
Unfortunately.
So there is a significant risk, and you will not know until you've done the surgery. And once the surgery is done, there's nothing you can do to correct it.
100% right.
Yeah. So this is why we want to, like, I want to just emphasize what Mickey's saying here. If you can fix whatever problem you have with glasses, do that. And leave the surgery alone until your flying days are over.
Yes.
Basically.
Fine.
All right.
That's what I say.
Good. All right. Then more questions. Color vision.
Yeah.
Color vision is probably one of the most common questions that I get. Okay. Can you have any kind of color deficiency and get the class one medical?
I would like to say no 100%, but I cannot do that. But there is a test that was called Ishiara that we use in Europe for that you should be able to see.
Is that the numbers test?
That's one. Yeah, that's that one where Ishiara test of color deficiency. And there's different numbers in there that you should be able to see. But some has just a slight. There is a time limit how long it will take until you can tell the numbers for the doctor.
Okay.
But if you're a little bit slow on it, you can do an extra test to check in a special way with a specialist.
So these are for people.
But I have to emphasize, this is done at the aeromedical center with a specialist right away for your first class one.
Okay.
Because then it's more or less defined. It is just some rare diseases that might affect the color visions after you have a class one.
So basically, you have to keep it simple, you should be able to do the Ishiara tests.
Yes.
And if you have the Ishiara test only in very special circumstances, if you're too slow to see it.
Yeah.
Then
or if there's some
small
deviations like some people have, you can have a class one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Good. So that brings us over to the more more serious stuff like heart disease.
Yes.
Yeah. I know that there's a lot of different types of heart disease.
There
obviously.
Is very many. Yeah.
Yes, yes. Generally speaking, when you go to do your class one medical or your recurrent class one medical, how do doctors view heart issues?
What we always do, we listen to your heart and you check your pulse. And on regular intervals, we check the rest ECG when you do your recurrent. I mean, you lay down on the bed, and we put all the electrodes on you, and then you check. We check the heart. Conditions that might affect then, that is if you have got some rhythm disturbances. That happens every once in a while. Hmm. But most pilots that have the class one, they have had a feeling that something is wrong. So they have called their aeromedical examiner or been to the hospital and see what's wrong. Because when you feel something is not good with the heart, you usually... It might be life-threatening.
Yes, of
and,
course.
And like you have been bringing up before in your pods, that is, if anything affects you, see the doctor right away. The easier we can, the faster we can catch this, the easier probably we can cure it.
Yeah, and if we can cure it, can you get your medical back?
Definitely.
Yes.
I have a number of pilots that, for example, have what we call atrial fibrillation when the when the heart doesn't beat regularly. Hmm. Within the chambers, and after they're treated for this, they come back. You can have a limitation for a while to fly in a dual pilot system only.
Yeah.
But for the guy I saw here the other day, that one was removed a couple of years, and he has not had symptoms since.
Okay.
So you can come back after some diseases. Even to today, with the good treatments we have, for example, for a heart attack, if the clot, which is actually a heart attack, can be dissolved properly in a certain time, the heart will function normal and you will come back as a class one pilot.
Yeah, and this is really important, and yet another reason why you have to be very honest with this, okay? Because if you find something early, which is actually one of the benefits of this occupation, that we do regular health checks.
Yes.
Because you can find something during these health checks, you can go to the doctor, get the specialist to hopefully treat it, and then come back as a commercial pilot after that.
Yes.
So be honest once again. So that's heart. Now, diabetes.
Yeah, diabetes with insulin now is more or less disqualifying. There is research today to see which we can do anything else, but I would say class one and insulin, that means you need injections to have control over your blood sugar.
Yeah.
Then that is disqualifying. But you can, for example, with your diet.
Yeah.
For example, if you have been a high consumer of drinks with a lot of carbohydrates or a lot of candy and stuff, and you reduce that to a minimum, you can actually come back to a normal level. And you can actually take some tablets that helps diabetes as well, and they are compatible with flying status. So that means you can fly with them.
So that's basically a very mild form of diabetes, like
yes.
It's the first stages of when this happens.
Yes, but also then, we have to remember that that disease usually goes along with obesity, which you can actually take care of yourself. Mm. And obesity and diabetes and high blood pressure is not a good combination.
No.
So that's very important that I, as an air medical examiner, tells the risks of that, and also try to help the person in order for the next check to lose some weight and be a little bit stricter with the diet in order to have a longer life.
Yeah.
And as a benefit, fly for a long time.
Absolutely. And this is also something that I keep pressing, and I've actually done a podcast about. You need to take care of yourselves, guys. Like, you need to do regular exercise. And me, who's doing this job and has been doing it for 15 years now, you've been a commercial pilot for 28 years.
That's correct.
We know that we've been sitting down a lot. Like, there's a lot of benefits to this job, but there is one downside, and that is you're sitting in bad sitting positions during a lot of hours, which means that you need to take care of your body. You need to go out and do regular exercise. You need to think about what you're eating.
Yes.
And this might sound like, you know, obvious, but you have to think about it and you have to do it.
Yes.
It's as easy as that.
And I can tell you, I mean, I was sitting on the old DC-9 chair, which was not the best one. And during those years, it went as bad, so I had a prolapsed disc that I had to have surgery on my back, because I've been sitting and not exercising in the right way.
Yeah, exactly. And you got your medical back after that?
I got my medical back.
Exactly.
And I would like to say, when you have the work, you're tired and stuff, but at least try to get a good physio who helps you with the back, because with a good back, the job will be easier and not so painful.
Great, that will be the number one tip from today.
Yeah.
Great. Right, so that brings us, we've been talking about obesity.
Yeah.
Right. So what about, can you be obese and be a pilot?
Yeah, I mean, there is limitations to that too. There is an actual limit, which a BMI of 35. And what's a BMI of 35? That is, let's say you are 180 centimeters long and around 110 kilos. If you go over that, your medical doctor will temporarily withdraw your license, and then you need to do extra medical checks, for example for snoring, and that you don't have any breathing losses during the sleep. You have to do an extra check on your heart. You have to take extra blood work, but that's when you're getting close to, otherwise you will not fly.
Okay.
Your license will be removed. And you have to think about one other thing that you as a commander know as well. You have to be able to evacuate.
Yes.
And you have a window.
Yeah.
And you have to be able to get through it. You don't want to sit like a plug in that window.
No, you've seen that video. You've seen the video that I made about opening the cockpit window. You see, that's the window you need to get out of. So you need to be not only fit through it, but also be agile enough to get your feet out.
Yeah. You know? And I can tell you, this summer I've done a medical flight test on a pilot that was on the limit. He actually had to do a medical flight test by an aeromedical examiner to get his license back. And now we have it under control, so he's under weight control every month in order to start his process with his life and his training in order to keep it. But now he's flying, but regular checks every month, and then so that's also an indication that we help people to come back.
Good. Okay, so the opposite then. Can you be too thin?
Of course, you cannot be anorectic.
Yeah.
I mean, you have to have proper health. I mean, if you're anorectic, you don't eat properly. And or maybe you have some malabsorption in your body that has to be investigated, but there is actually not a skin level. But as an aeromedical examiner, you have to see that you should not be on a diet properly as a pilot, because you have to have your carbohydrates and your energy to fly. Because sometimes, like, you know, energy blows quick and you need it.
Yes, yes.
And if you have any kind of emergency or something, you need energy, and it might take an hour or two anyhow that you're down on ground.
And
so you have to be refueled
and
not too skinny. But on your limit, too skinny, no. But I have to examine that you're in a good
physical shape, basically. Yes, normal healthy stuff.
Yes.
Good. What about height then? Can you be... Let's say, are there any height limits for the medical part?
There is not any defined limits, but companies have different limits, because you cannot be too short, because then you will not reach the rudder pedals, as example, and you have to be able to get onto all the different buttons in the ceiling.
Yeah.
And in another way, you cannot be too long either, because you cannot sit like this bent for a career, because you will have neck problem and other problems. But they are not luckily so common. But Some companies have them, and I have done a height check on occasion, but that was on the short range. But
what kind of limits are we talking about? Ish, if you talk, it's 150, 160.
I would say 165. Some were in centimeters. Around there is a limit in order to reach certain and the pedals.
Yeah.
But you can actually also do a medical flight test on it.
Yeah.
And it might even be specified on one aircraft only.
Okay.
But that's very specific and more for the companies.
Okay.
But the aeromedical examiner does not actually do that. But I would say for the, you shall check it out. So you don't make all this energy to be a pilot, and then it would not accept you because of that limitation.
No.
That's tragic.
No, of course. And this goes to what I've been talking about many times before, that you have to get your medical, you have to do your psychological evaluation, like your pilot aptitude test before you start signing any papers to pay for very, very expensive training, because it's really, really sad to find out afterwards that
yes.
This is going to be a problem. Yep. So make sure that you do that, guys. Let's see, I'm going to have to check now, because I've done on the Facebook page, I've sent out questions to see if there's any new questions that has come in since we have you here. I think we've covered most of them. And do you have anything else that you would like to add to the viewers out there now, since we have you here? And also I'm gonna probably send you some questions via
okay.
email,
because
I realize that these covers the broad pictures
yeah.
of all of the questions that I've been getting, but I've also been getting very specific questions about, for example, back problems.
Yes.
Can you, like, are there any limits to what kind of back problems or diseases you can
yeah,
have?
I mean, you have to be able to move properly.
Yep.
There are certain limits of scoliosis and more or less S-typed vertebral column
okay.
that might affect you, or you might have a slight deficiency that won't not affect you, but that will be checked during your initial
mm.
and also recurrent. But like you were bringing up here, the overall health is very important, and even I, as an American aeromedical examiner, cannot answer all the questions, and everything is not written 100% in the manuals. And then I have to consult the authority,
mm.
the CEA, and their specialists in aviation medicine, and even them, they have further specialists in certain cases. But on a general broad, I think you've gotten the most things here. And then there's, of course, special cases that you should consult an aeromedical examiner.
Yes, absolutely. And that's important as well, guys, that, you know, these very, very specific questions that I've been getting, you are probably going to have to go in and consult with different doctors, maybe not one, but several experts within
yeah.
that field. There's one thing that I wanted to cover as well, which I've gotten some questions about, and that is like psychological things, for example, ADHD from
okay,
a
that's
young level.
Psychiatric.
Psychiatric. ADHD.
Yeah.
For example, at an early age, someone has been diagnosed for that during the early teens, for example.
Yeah.
What about that? Can you still become a pilot if you've been diagnosed with that?
Yes, I would say yes, you can actually, but you cannot be under treatment with pharmacological substances.
Okay.
Let's say you had it, like I said, in the early teens, and that was some years that for different reasons was like they were.
Mm.
And then the doctors has decided that to withdraw the medication,
mm.
and you feel fine, and everything is back to normal.
Yes.
When you then come to your class one medical,
yeah.
you should definitely bring that up, like we've been talked before. And then they will require more documents from the earlier history,
mm.
The doctor's evaluation, and the specialist at the aviation authority will look through them, and if everything is fine with their psychiatric expertise, then you will have a class one medical certificate.
Good. So once again, be honest, you might get some more questions, they might be hard, but you have to answer them. They have
yeah.
to be answered
yes.
before you can be entrusted with flying a commercial airline. So
definitely.
It's as easy as that.
Yes.
Yeah, I think that basically wraps it up.
Okay.
Thank you very much for joining me on the channel.
Pleasure.
I'm sure there might be more. We
okay.
might see more of Mickey in the future.
Okay.
With that, guys, as always, remember to subscribe to the channel. I'm doing whatever I can now, guys, to answer all of the questions that I'm getting. And the more of you guys who are signing up and viewing and sharing this with your friends, the more that enables me to do this. For example, come here to Scandinavian Aviation Academy and ask Mickey these questions. So tell people about the channel, and I hope you're having a fantastic day wherever you are. See you next time. Bye-bye.